What is up, my friends? You know I always start this show off by showing love to those companies who help make this podcast possible. Guys, first is my friends over at Yellow Jacket. I'm going to be announcing tonight, I'm going to be giving away some awesome Yellow Jacket stuff. Guys, I always say this about Yellow Jacket. I know nowadays we're all about the flashy stuff and, you know, this thing can, you can change the oil while taking a shit and, you know, it does this, but I am one of those people that I firmly believe I want the tool to do what it's intended to do. I want a vacuum pump to be very, very good at pulling moisture out of the system. If I use that tool properly, it's going to do a very good job. And every time I turn it on, I want it to be dependable and exactly what I'm, you know, I have it there to do. My gauges, my combustion analyzer, my manometer, whatever it is. And I have always said that I know that Yellow Jacket is not the flashiest, you know, tool company when it, you know, comes to a lot of them out there. And there's a lot of people that make great tools, so I'm not saying that. But I have always said that Yellow Jacket is dependable. Every tool I've ever had from them, when I needed to use that specific tool, it's done exactly what it was intended to do. And for me, that's half the battle. It's half the battle right there. I think they're kicking ass with a lot of their new stuff. This combustion analyzer, bang for the buck, is absolutely amazing. I'll be giving one of those out here soon. Also, I'll be giving one of their Y-Jack Manos away as well. And this turbo recovery machine, I think I said this before, our team at Beltway love it. It's A2L certified. It's good for all that new stuff coming down the pipeline, so it's future-proof. And we literally had to buy another recovery machine for another install team that we hired. And when I asked the install manager, what should I buy? I'll be honest. I was expecting him to say the field piece one. And he's like, to be honest, that Yellow Jack one's pretty badass and it's fast. Why don't you get that one? And I was like, you don't have to say that, man, just because of Yellow Jacket. And he was like, no, I'm not. I think that's the one you should get. And I was like, awesome. So it made me feel good. So guys, go check out my friends over at Yellow Jacket. Some of that summer money, hopefully you just made. You're going to be updating some of your tools, buying some new stuff, if at all possible. All I say is give my friends over at Yellow Jacket a look. That's all I ask. Just getting ready to say something else, and I seem to have forgotten. So yeah, buy Yellow Jacket. Oh, I was going to say, no matter what digital manifold you choose to buy, this is, to me, is a no-brainer. It should have Yellow Jacket hoses hooked up to it. So God forbid you choose another manufacturer's, manifold. At least you should have Yellow Jacket hoses hooked up to it because, to me, they are the best in the business. That's not even a debate. So let's move on to the next one. Guys, I'm going to be announcing, me and my friends at Bluon hooked up again to give something back to you guys tonight, which I'll be announcing here in just a little bit. Guys, I don't know if you saw a video that I put out on Instagram the other day when I tell you that Bluon has made so many things simple. We know about the manuals, the tech support. Yes, now the tech support, you have to be using the ordering to be able to get the free tech support. I get it. That sucks for some people because you're in a position where you can't make that decision. I get that. It was free for a long time and a lot of people chose not to take advantage of it. But if you can, and you can do all these different things, buy the parts that your company was going to buy anyway through the same accounts, you can win money. So we have a girl, Destiny, who works in our office who orders all of the parts. And I set her up at a Bluon account that she uses. Just the other day, she won $276 for doing her fucking job. She was like, Gil, is this real money? I was like, yeah, that's real money. They sent her a text. Hey, thank you for using it. A little survey. It was a little spinny wheel. She clicked it, happened to hit $250. Then she ordered some parts a little bit later, did it again, won like $25, $26. It was $276 that she cast down a gift card. That's her money to do whatever the hell she chooses to do with it. So guys, you have all these resources for you to help make your job easier, and then you can get paid for doing your job. How is that not fucking awesome? You're getting a little extra money in your pocket for doing what you were going to do anyway, and you didn't buy the parts in the first place. But guys, I don't know what you're waiting for. Help Bluon upgrade the HVAC industry and download the app today. All right, let's go. Do the pledge and on to the show. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. God bless the United States, and thank you to all those men and women who defend it. Fucking buttons weren't working.
Welcome to the number one rated HVAC podcast. If you're looking to grow in the HVAC industry, then you're in the right spot. Blue collar people talking about blue collar shit. Let's get better together. So turn up the volume, buckle your seatbelt, and let's welcome your host, Gil Cavey Jr.
What is up, everybody? Welcome back to the HVAC Uncensored podcast. I'm your host, Gil Cavey Jr. Here we are, another Wednesday night. First and foremost, I want to... This fucking chair, what are we doing here? Apologize about last week, man. I was very happy to be going by myself, to not have a little break from a guest, that we could just relax and BS. And the scenes, like you see, the border that's around me, all of that stuff. I opened up my software and they were gone. They were nowhere to be found. I still don't know what happened. I have most of them have been recreated. So you'll notice some little different nuances and stuff like that. Whatever. Maybe it was a godsend. I wanted to change the order of some things and stuff like that. So try to add some new ones, different things like that. So I apologize about last week. That is what happened. I had full intention of podcasting. And when I got down here 20 minutes before 8, realized that I couldn't recreate all the ones that I needed in 20 minutes. So that's why the show was canceled, just so everybody knows. But guys, I have a great show for you tonight. He has probably been on the show more than anybody, to be honest. I was thinking about people that have been on multiple times. And over the years, I don't think anybody's been on more than this person. So I love it when he comes on. We always have good, intelligent talks about different things in the trade. And this guy says he's not an HVAC guy, but that's bullshit. And I'll always tell him that. He knows that. He's a very, very smart guy, and he understands things on a different level. And I truly enjoy our conversations. I've been able to meet Nate in person several times now, and I really, really enjoy our conversations. So guys, please help me welcome Mr. Co-founder, I guess that's what you call it. I know he has a partner of HVAC 2.0, Mr. Nate Adams. Hold on, I got to unmute you now. There we go.
It's good to be back. It's number five.
Yeah, I think it's more than that. Are you counting the time you came on with me and Kelly back in the day?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure. Maybe I missed one because I made a webpage that I'll show at the end where I pulled up the old ones the other day.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I know it's been quite a few times, and I was like, I think Nate has definitely, he's got that badge of honor as the multiple time guest on HVAC Uncensored. So let's, where's that button? So anyway, I got the scenes made. Forgetting to hit buttons like I'm a fucking rookie and everything. It's echoing. Nate is echoing. Let's see what we got here.
Is that better?
No, it might not even be you, man.
I just got a text from my partner, Echo. I had YouTube open to watch the comments because I can't see comments in here.
Yeah, I don't think there should be a button for you to click. I don't know if it's going to let me open this up, though. Let me see if it lets me open it up while we are live. Hold on. Yeah, it does. Audio. Works. Yeah, it says reverb. God damn it, man. It stops working.
Well, it's good if it's on your end. I'm trying to figure out what I might have messed up on mine.
Yeah, but a lot of times if it's from you, it's not you. Hold on, let me see. That's right. He said that's not, it's just, okay, I think we got it fixed. Good.
I just got a text that we're good. So
yeah, there's an echo cancellation thing on here that when I was changing some settings, I don't ever come through the speakers. So technically, if you read what it says, I shouldn't have to have echo cancellation on. But apparently, if I don't, it gives you guys an echo. So I don't fucking know.
Hey, well, we're figuring it out one step at a time, right?
Yeah, it's one step at a time.
It's kind of funny, too, because you've had me on three times this year, which is incredible. Thank you. But we've been screwing around with the 2.0 software and like trying to get things working right. And finally, like 6 months later than I was hoping, everything's working pretty much as I want. So nice. Software can be a pain.
And, you know, it's definitely a pain. But one thing I love about what you do with this is, let's be honest, most guys that are really good and they're really technical, they don't like the sales part, or they end up doing too much work that they don't have to do, if that makes sense. You know, or they do the work for the wrong
juice.
Yeah. To where something like this helps those guys that are really technical, that maybe they're not great communicators. It helps them package all this stuff in one package to be able to present it, follow the script, and be able to do a more technical but amazing consult with a customer. That's what we need. We need to combat these big conglomerate, you know, private equity firms or these big giant companies. I won't say any names. People know what I'm talking about. Everybody's got one close to you. That they just walk in and bamboozle people, and they may get a good install. They may not get a good install. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, I've seen good installs from big companies, but generally I see mediocre ones. And I've seen some that where I'm like, was that the Craigslist special? Like, what company sticker is on that box? Like, you got to be kidding me. Like, I'm not a technician. I'm not an HVAC tech. I now know quite a bit about HVAC from being around a whole bunch of people.
HVAC technicians.
What's that?
I said you know more than some HVAC technicians. Let's be honest. I'm gonna do lasers. Watch. Sorry, I found a feature I didn't know about. So if random shit pops up on the screen, because
Gil's having fun. But I mean, you make a good point though. Like we were just talking about before the show, and one thing that we've been working on with an HVAC 2.0, because we've been super nerdy. Let's be frank. I'm a nerd. The stuff we do is nerdy. It feels hard to jump up into. It feels like this big lift, and that's bothered us for years, but we just didn't know what the hell to do about it. And we have a significant problem in the HVAC industry. Hey, there you go. So I was trying to make it so people could learn easy. The home comfort book right there. Yeah, NateTheHouseWhisperer.com. You can download most of that for free. And if you want to buy a copy, knock yourself out. It's a pretty book.
It is.
I'm lucky to be married to a designer. So Rachel made that thing look really nice. Way nicer than I ever would. That's for damn sure. Most HVAC installs suck. And I've actually seen the numbers on it. So I asked Jim Bergman a couple of years ago for a data set on static pressure, external static pressure, total external static pressure. And it turns out that 70% of systems in that database that he had, he gave me about 800 systems, and they were pretty nationally representative, were above half an inch of water column. Is that okay, according to most OEMs?
No.
70% are out of spec. And then, it was actually a study, I think, on Bergman's Measure Quick data from NIST, but upwards of 90% of residential systems have a detectable fault. That's hideous. You know, be that low airflow, refrigerant temperatures are out of whack, you know, static pressure, you know, whatever it might be, something is easily detectable that is wrong in the install. Now, we can go in and blame the technicians. And there's definitely some fault there because we've seen some really shady installs.
Getting people installing inverters and the inverter's not doing what it's supposed to, and it's not the system's fault.
It's choked. Yeah.
Yeah. We get these ones where, like, I go look at them and I'm like, oh my God, like, you guys have never really experienced inverter technology because this thing's all fucking jacked up.
Yeah. Or you don't change any settings and the way that you installed it requires a little bit of commissioning and a little bit of changing settings. So, I mean, I have a total man crush on the Carrier Infinity Stat, and I know we share that man crush. I would damn near marry the thing if I could. We can blame a lot of that on technicians, but one thing that I think we fail to consider is a lot of this actually goes back to the sales side of things. I mean, if you have, like, so say back when you were just a technician, I mean, now you're a manager, so you have control over this, but when you were just a technician and you were given a 4-ton piece of equipment and it really only had 2.5 or 3 tons of ductwork, how do you fix that? You don't.
You wouldn't. And you'd just, oh, it's a 4-ton, and then you'd offer it. So any of our guys, just not to interrupt you, but any of our guys who have the ability to sell have to know how to do a manual J. They have to.
And that's a funny thing, because on heating, we find that it's not just off by a little bit. It's usually about double what reality is for heating.
Especially in the Northeast. Because most of the homes were only ever sized for heating, and it was sized incorrectly, you know? And then people added air conditioning on top, and they wonder why shit never worked right. It's, you know, that's why I've always talked about when I go in, I'm not the cheapest guy because I'm going to fix everything. Like, hey, I'd love to sell you this. And I told you, we've been doing a lot of Lennox stuff, which I've always been a Carrier guy, but I do really love, I think their signature line is, I think it's too expensive. It's good equipment. But they're elite line. They have an EL22 is the heat pump, and the EL23 is the AC. I'm actually liking this stuff. Their S40 thermostat, I don't think it's as good as the Carrier, but it's pretty sweet. I'll take it. But we've been installing some of these, and some of the issues that I'm finding with some of these houses when I go in with people, and, you know, like we talked about before I would not install some things. Now I tell them, like, hey, you need to do, this is the system price, and we need to do this, this, and this. And if they're like, oh, well, I can't do all that. Okay. But you're going to sign off saying that you wanted me to not do this, this, and this. And if something happens to the equipment before that, I'm going to leave it to the manufacturer to make judgment on if your warranty is still valid. Some people, that's enough to scare them into doing it. And I don't want to do that, but I want them to know what they're doing, that this is a bigger decision when they just, oh, I don't want that. Like, this isn't something I get it in sales. Sometimes you have to give them something to say no to. This is not one of those things.
Yeah, it's that's always such a challenge. And so you have a pretty decent idea looking at a house, vaguely what's wrong and what's not. And I mean, and so do I at this point. I mean, like, when it comes to insulation and air sealing, I can scope about half of homes from the street. But just because that I think it needs $30,000 in work doesn't mean they're going to buy it. It still has to be sold. You know, they need to see the value and be willing to write the check. And the same thing is true on the HVAC side. If they, like, look at your price and they fall over dead, like, that's not going to be helpful. They're not going to buy that. And then they're going to buy something that's going to break, and it'll join those 70% of systems that are upwards of upwards of half an inch. By the way, on the 0.7 of an inch, which that's pretty much where people agree early failure becomes likely. Like, it's not for sure, but above 0.7 of an inch of water column for the external static pressure, you might lose the system a few years early. You might lose it 5 years early. 47% of systems in that data set. Mm. So damn near half of systems are installed so wrong that the odds are they're going to fail early. And so we can blame technicians. We can blame manufacturers. And yeah, there's pieces of the puzzle there. But I would argue a huge chunk of it is the wrong system got sold in the first place. is you can't fix that. I mean, particularly single stage. What are the two things you can adjust in single stage equipment?
Fan speed.
Airflow and charge.
Yeah.
That's what you got. Yeah. You can trim it. You can add it. You can add 6 pounds like some people do. But I mean, there's not much you can do to play with a single stage system. And 85% of systems that are sold are single stage. Also, about 85% are emergency replacements. And I think those two numbers are fairly strongly related to each other. So what we've been trying to figure out now, like the goal of HVAC 2.0 the whole time has been, how do we give anyone who wants one a truly comfortable and truly healthy home? So good indoor air quality, however you want to define that. Good indoor environmental quality is actually a better way to define it, Robert Bean's way. And not only that, but make it so that the person who is selling and doing the work actually enjoys their life. Because it's really easy to give the farm away and not make much. I managed to do that in insulation contracting. I got to where the work that I did was better than what I was charging, and I watched my margins go bloop. So home performance and doing good work basically killed my profitability, and I shut the company down. So at least I shut it down before everything went totally to crap. So like I joke, I didn't go down with a plane. I at least jumped out and pulled the parachute before it crashed into the cliff. But that was a really painful experience to learn. And it was fundamentally a value building problem. I wasn't building enough value for my clients that they were willing to pay extra to do the work the way that it needed to be done.
And also, people have come where shitty work is the norm. Oh, well, my cousin can do it for $6,500. Okay, well, your cousin's a retard, and that's a piece of shit equipment. You know what I mean? So that's people who, like, you know, I love Ben Poole says it, you're masters of your craft. And if you're those people who do things right, if you go in there and you have legitimate resources and you can educate the customer, this is why you shouldn't do that and why you should do this. Because when they do this, you're going to have ABCD problems. If you don't do this, you're going to have ABCD problem. You know what I mean? You have to educate them. And most people will be like, I've went into those people. I get some of our guys like, hey, Gil, these people are like, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. We can't do it. And then I go there and the guys are like, holy shit. I'm like, yeah, because I'm confident and I know what I'm talking about. You guys know the same shit I know. You're just not confident yet. That's the only difference.
Confident. And part of it too, I think, is having a third party arbiter of truth. If you've ever heard that term, you know, it's like saying the Bible says in front of something. Like some people you're just going to turn off, but a bunch of people are going to listen up. But you need to have that third party of, you know, here's the resource and the authority that this is coming from. And that can be really useful, particularly if you're not confident in yourself. And that takes a while. And that brings us to another big challenge on the sales side. When you look at big companies, you got a good comment coming. When you look at big companies,
Chris. Look, I even wore your shirt tonight. Didn't know you were going to be here, bro. But yes, I'll take some.
Hey, Chris.
Be honest with you. I get what you're saying, though. Like, it's like the manufacturer says, the American Gas Association says, like, you're using higher powers to prove your point. And yeah, no, I think we had this conversation before because we're on the same page with that.
That can be helpful. I mean, it's just the classic, well, I have to ask my wife, which is the same higher power excuse. You know, it really is. You're tapping out for something else. But one challenge that we have is the big companies typically bring in people that don't have much HVAC experience that are out there selling HVAC. HVAC is not the simplest product to sell. So what happens? They sell the wrong stuff. And then all of us as technicians have to go in and try and make it work as best we can. You know, the classic, well, just make it happen. Well, you can make it happen, but it doesn't work. You know, it's like jamming a Hemi in a Prius or something, which, by the way, has been done. And it's like an 8.5 second car.
Are you making upgrades to your Prius, Nate?
I couldn't believe it. I wanted to use that as an example, and I typed in Hemi and a Prius. I'm like, holy crap, there it is. The thing rocks down the track. So I doubt it corners for squat, but it's good in a quarter mile. But that car got carefully thought through and redone to make that motor actually go in there and got switched from front wheel to rear wheel. You know, like that was a lot of work. But if you work for a big company, they're like, hey, we need you to do 2 installs a day. Are you going to do what you need to make that install come anywhere close to work? No, you don't have the time. I mean, more often than not, I mean, you're not brazing with nitrogen and you're not doing a good vacuum. So you just took half the life out of that system for once of maybe an hour of install time.
I'll be honest, and I'll get your opinion on this. One thing that we've went for the installers is, obviously, I've gotten things from, you know, RLS and also ZoomLock Max, but with those press fittings. But I love those pieces, but I don't like the cutting the bell off of condensers. So we've actually been using the, what is the name of it? The soft solder that is for refrigeration.
I think I know what you mean. It doesn't create soot.
Yes. So we've actually been doing that on the valves and then pressing everything else. And because as we grow and we're getting ready to have exponential growth, and I'm trying to put fires out before they happen. And not that I don't trust my guys, but I get how it works. Everybody's not brazing with nitrogen. Maybe they did this job. Hey, it was really bad day. I'm not doing this one. So now I can get to the point where they don't necessarily have to, because we're not creating anything on the inside of the lines. You know, we try to replace every line set. The ones we can't, we're using the pipe wiper, you know, so that we can flush them out, because I don't like R11 flush either. I just don't like the solvent. If when it gets in there and causes a problem, that's worse for the system than a little bit of mineral oil left behind by the R22 system. So I didn't mean to go off on a rant, but
these are important pieces of the puzzle. And like, you need to have good processes, but good processes can deal with imperfect installs and still deliver good results.
Yeah.
But that's a lot of what we play with an HVAC 2.0. Like, what can we do where even if it's done halfway decently, it still works really well? And that's a really hard thing to balance back and forth, because we understand what perfection is and what perfection looks like. But if you require perfection, man, people are going through divorces. It's Miller time. Your back hurts. You're thinking about your kid's game. You want to get off early. You know, there's so many different things where if you require perfection in installs, you're going to fail. So how do we find the things that really matter and make it so that those are as robust as possible?
Yeah. Stay Bright 8. That's what it's called. Mr. Andrew Lish. And actually saying his name from Facebook. That's the one that I was talking about.
So yeah, there's all these pieces of the puzzle though. And like for years now, 2.0 has been crazy nerdy. You know, it's been hard to learn. It's been really steep. And so one way I've been starting to think about it is it's like a really cool pool. Have you ever been to a pool that just like has everything? It's got the cool water slide. It has a splash pad. It's got the shallow end. It's got the deep end. It's got the high dive. And hell, let's throw in, you know, there's part that's deep enough that you can go scuba diving. We have only really had the deep end for a long time. So you've had to really kind of dive in and commit and learn as much as you can. And it's too much. For most people, it just is. So that end is still there. But what we've been trying to do is build in the shallow end where we can all throw balls around and go play with our kids in the splash pad and stuff like that. So this has been the challenge that we've been trying to figure out for a couple of years now. And ironically, this was almost harder than figuring out how to do the good work, like the deep work. Because now, again, we have to build processes that you can put a newbie through and have them survive and sell the right product and take at least hopefully some details of what the install needs to be and educate the customer. And like all of these different pieces of the puzzle have to happen. And that was way harder than I ever would have thought it would be.
And to be honest, I think when you say about, you know, you made it a little bit, you know, I think it was daunting because people thought they couldn't do it. Like it was too hard for them or it was above them that when they actually realized it and tried, maybe some things would have been hard. But one thing I give you is, like you always said, it was an amazing community around it. You weren't just by yourself. It wasn't just, hey, fuck you, figure it out. You know what I mean? You had this community around you. So I think that by doing what you're doing is going to get more people to realize, oh shit, I should have done this sooner. You know, like this wasn't like, I don't know how to do a blower door test, or, you know, I can't afford to do that, or whatever it was. Like it, you took out all those questions, you know, or those, not questions, those excuses for people to be able to do it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, to be fair, so the comfort consult, which involves the blower door test, a number of people have done that. And the key thing for that is we recommend go do it for a couple of people as a test, because the first time you're going to be just sketchy doing it. Like you're going to be reading stuff and you're going to be confused. You're going to be fumbling over yourself as you put up the blower door for the first time in front of someone. But man, if you're technically handy, I put one up in front of a technician. And then I tore it down because I didn't like how the shroud was. And I looked at the tech that had been watching me. I'm like, put it up. And I didn't give him any coaching. 10 minutes later, it's up and he did it perfect. Like, it's not hard. And A-Team Adam was the same way. And I showed it. I put something up again. I didn't like exactly how it was. And so I tore it down. I'm like, Adam, put it up. And he gets it up and done. And he's like, that's it? I'm like, yeah, that's it. Like, it's not that hard. But it's scary. I mean, new things are always scary.
Yeah.
And then the process itself, like it's a script. Can you read a script? Seriously, can you ask questions and type down what the people tell you? That's all it took. So it wasn't that hard. But one of the issues that we had there was, who do you tell about the comfort consult and who do you not tell? Because you're looking for the problem houses and the clients that have challenges and maybe the clients that you suspect might actually pay for A, the diagnostics, and B, the better solution. Yeah. So you're cherry picking. And what needs to happen instead is you need to tell everyone about, you need to ask every client a few questions. The first one, which we've now stacked on top of everything, is, are you hoping that this new HVAC system does anything different than what your old one did? And if they say no, it's probably going to be like for like. But if they say yes, then you ask them a few questions. And their answers to those questions give them a score. And that score leans them either towards a free quote or the comfort consult. And that was the big piece that we just didn't have. We just didn't know how to have every client get offered those two paths and let them choose. And so now we've created this really nice choose your own adventure. Do you remember reading those books as a kid?
Oh, yeah.
Come up to the haunted mansion. Are you going to go up to the front door? Are you going to sneak in the back? And there's all kinds of different choices you make after that. And usually you die and then you have to figure out, you know, keep going back in how many steps you made and figure out where you fork off to get to the other end.
Yeah. I always went in the front door. If I'd have snuck in the back door, I mean, I have four kids. So you never know. But it's funny what you're saying, because what we teach and what I've learned throughout, you know, different classes when it comes to sales is it's, you know, transactional and relational customers. Transactional people only want price. They don't give a fuck about you, what you know, how smart you are. They're only worried about price. Relational customers want to know about you. They want to build that relationship. They're willing to pay a little bit more money. And the sooner you can figure that out, the better that you can provide an option for those people. Because if you waste your time trying to build this amazing system for a transactional person, guess what? They're not going to buy anything from you. You're too expensive. That's not what I want. Yeah, thanks. Yep. Email me. I'll call you later. And then it also, and I never did this, Ryan, the owner of Beltway, got us into it, is the Myers-Briggs. And when you figure out what somebody is, you know, whether somebody is
ENFP.
Yep. I'm definitely an E.
But I know you are.
Yeah, whether somebody is an extrovert or an introvert, you know, extroverts, a lot of times you can talk to the introverts, they want that documentation. They want to read it, you know, they don't want to hear you talk to them. They want to read it. So knowing, you know, what that is, that's almost half the battle. So sometimes it's not that you're doing anything wrong. You just, well, you don't know how to do what you're trying to do, if it makes sense.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's the curse for most salespeople and really most technicians. Because, I mean, most technicians, in my experience, aren't the best salespeople. They're technicians. They're good at figuring out what's wrong and getting that thing fixed and getting the system running and going from there. I mean, that's where their skills lie. And so if you try to turn them into hardcore salespeople, it's probably not going to go well.
No.
But their job, for the most part, is ultimately in building trust with the client. And that's what you want them to do. And they can offer options, you know, like, look, here's the Band-Aid solution, you know, might die tomorrow. But, you know, it's not expensive, so we could try it. But I'm also testing that this, this, and this are wrong. And then where the one question of, are you hoping that a new system might do something different? Or the four questions of comfort issues and so forth. That comes into play. You know, it's a 12-year-old system. The compressor's bad. Like, it's,
yeah.
I don't want to tell you you need to replace it, but replacement should be on the table as an option. We can either put it on the table, you're welcome to take it off the table, but if I don't put it on the table, I'm not doing my job.
Let me ask you this. When it comes to HVAC 2.0, do you think this is more built for the tech turnover type sale or like just a straight up sales call? Or does it matter?
The free quote process is built for the in-person sales.
Okay.
But the four questions of asking the clients what's bothering them and having them rank things and get their score, that is great for a tech turnover. And we think that the tech should then get, you know, paid a percentage of that lead.
Yeah.
You know, you can pick your percentage, be that 2, be that 5, you know, whatever. That is a really good way to do that, because then they are shifting gears and they're handing off. It was bad. Did you ever see the Pink Panther with Steve Martin?
Oh yeah.
It was a terrible movie, but there was one scene that was funny where he played both good cop and bad cop. And the person just started laughing at them. It's like, you're the same guy. What the heck? Like, you can't do that. So when a role changes, ideally you need another person to come in. And so that's one thing where having a salesperson go out can be good. And then we actually view it as there should be two different levels of salespeople. So salesperson one is your entry level, just person who's kind of new, and you put them through the free quote process and they're okay. Salesperson two is one that knows how to run the blower door and understand something about home performance, and they've taken the time to learn and they've shown interest in learning.
Yeah.
So there's two different pieces there, but the key thing is there needs to be a consistent process where the client gets educated. And then one of the things that we're big on that I know you like as well is, like you were saying earlier, like, if we don't do this, this is probably going to fail. And then you have them sign off. We call that responsibly avoiding responsibility. I don't have control over this and I'm not getting paid. I'm not going to own this. You are. Sign here. And the biggest thing we think needs to get done with that is the static pressure side of things. Or we call it duct pressure, because homeowners don't understand external static pressure. Nobody knows what the hell that is. Duct pressure. Oh, okay. Great. You stole it. Excellent.
Yeah. I love it because people understand it more. Customers understand. I agree 100%. You say static, you say, oh, static pressure. And then you got to sit there and look at the deer in the headlights look exactly. And then try to explain it to them. When you say duct pressure, kind of like blood pressure, they're like, oh, okay. Oh. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, you have to be careful not to lose people. I mean, it's like telling a joke and having to explain the punchline. It's not funny, and you didn't enjoy telling it, and they didn't enjoy getting it. Like, it just, it's dumb. So we have to try and use words that they're okay with without being, you know, silly.
Yeah.
You know, creating new names for capacitors. I'm not a huge fan of that personally. But in any case, we need a different way of doing it that's consistent. We need to be providing upfront third-party education, if at all possible, to our clients and help them understand. So this is part of what's been really hard to build. So like my book, it's a couple hundred pages long, something like that. The HVAC chapter is the cheapest, free. But it's only 16 pages, but most people aren't going to read that. So I managed to call it down to a 4-minute video. And then I've got a 90-second video on duct pressure that helps people understand duct pressure versus blood pressure and how that's a really important thing. And then you offer them duct pressure testing if you're at all comfortable with it. So that's going to be a tricky thing with your newbie salespeople. And I still get nervous punching holes, installing test ports, excuse me. David Richardson would smack me sideways or I was saying drilling holes, but we're drilling holes and I'm nervous about hitting a coil or a heat exchanger because I don't work on the equipment every day. So I don't have an intuitive view of what's inside. I see you're looking for the HVAC 101 chapter.
I was looking through it. First I was trying to see how many pages there was.
Yeah, it's 200-ish, something like that. We need to educate people quickly and offer them education multiple times, if at all possible. So that if they're like, well, you didn't tell me about that, you can go back and like, well, here's 3 emails. Plus, when I went through the sales process, I offered you to watch those videos while I was there and you declined. What am I supposed to do? 5.5 minutes of video when you're about to make a $10, $15, $20, $30,000 decision and you don't want to do it. Okay. Like
a lot of people don't realize it. We don't think about it is most people only do this once in their life.
Yes. Yeah,
how people are buying and, you know, moving. They're only going to make a purchase of this magnitude on their HVAC system. Probably once, most people, maybe twice. That's it. You know, and by the time they do it, so much things have changed in between. It's re-education. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you have to come at it. And I mean, we want to offer them truly HVAC, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. Like we want to do all of it. I pull it down into the 6 functions of HVAC. So load matching, you want variable speed equipment that can match what the house needs, heating and cooling wise, almost all the year. You know, you want good filtration to knock the garbage out of the air, also keeps the equipment clean so you don't need UV lights. Dehumidification, fresh air, mixing, and humidification. Those are your 6. And if you educate clients by showing them how their car HVAC works, because everybody understands intuitively how that works, and cars do 5 of 6. They don't do humidification, but they do everything else really well. If you help them understand those pieces of the puzzle, and then you show them options that deliver those or not, you show them which ones do and which ones don't, you're not like, so what's better about this one? Oh, it's more efficient. Who cares? You're going to save $50 a year? Yeah, whoop-de frickin' do. Seriously, the difference in energy use between like an 18 and 20 series system is usually 25 to 50 a year. It doesn't matter. It's a $2,000 upgrade. Doesn't matter. So so what we've come up with, I'd love it if you want to pop up my screen there. I want to walk through the report that we've been working on.
I'm going to put that up here real fast, something I didn't do. And while I know people start to leave till the end, I want to break off one thing really fast.
Yeah.
So guys, real fast, I want to do 2 things. So one, I've teamed up with Bluon for a giveaway. I'll announce that one right now. I'll talk about another one later. So I have a Vito Tech LC that I am going to give away. I'm going to announce it on social media, but you have to be a Bluon member. So all you have to be, you have to have a Bluon account is what I'm saying. So you have to go on to Bluon. It's for free. I get it that, you know, you may not be able to use some of the features, but all I need is to say this person won, contact my rep at Bluon, contact Jessica. She will search for your name. As long as your name is in there, ding, ding, you're a winner. Okay. So that's all you have. That's all you have to do. You got to be in there. The more you use it, the great. So a Tech LC. And I'm also going to do something else. 2 guys that have helped me a lot. One, you guys know, Rookie is always in here. Rookie, if you text me the Vito bag that you want, I will buy it for you and ship it to you. as a thank you. Rookie has always helped me and always done different things, and he's never asked for anything. So, dude, if you send me what you want, I will, you know, get it for you. I'll just buy it from TrueTech and have it shipped directly to you. And another person, I still have the old bag, but I never sent it out. Mr. Jason Johnson, if you let me know a veto bag that you want, I will do the same thing for you, my friend. I have that old beat up one back here, but I'm not going to send that one to you now. So if you let me know what you want, I will do the same thing for you, my man. So that being said, stay tuned. So find out how to win this, and you have to, all you got to do is be a member of Bluon, just in their database. That's all I'm asking for. And last but not least, also stay tuned because I have the Yellow Jacket giveaway that is going to be a combustion analyzer, a vacuum pump, and the manometer. All right?
Crap, I want that.
I got one. With that being said, let's go into this next screen.
Let's see here. Can I play with mine a little bit here? There we go. Play with the resolution on my end. So I should start off. What we were looking for, this is not perfect yet. It works. It works halfway decently. If you're expecting it to be perfect, it ain't. So the offer that we have on the table, we're looking for, strangely enough, 12 salespeople in particular, or Gil owners like you that are looking to scale up and build a sales department. That's what we're looking for to start pushing this out there and figuring out where our problems are, because we know there's going to be rough edges in this still. But that's what we're looking for. And the key thing that we will do there is we will help you one-on-one for free. We'll teach you. That's not a cheap thing.
No.
to learn from people like us. So if you're interested, it's actually really simple. It's hvac20.com/uncensored. I wonder where that came from. And you'll find episodes on there, but you can sign up. I'll show you that page in a little bit. But what I wanted to show for now, we've been talking about, you need to sell the right thing. The right thing needs to get sold, or as a tech, like, you can't fix it. You know, so you can't unfuck things when they're really fucked up. You just, there's no make it work. So how do we deal with that? And for starters, we need to do some client education, and in particular, ask them a few questions. So these are the four questions that you're seeing on my screen here. So these are simplified versions. There's a long question that helps cue people, like when you walk up the stairs, do you notice that it's a lot hotter? Do you notice rooms that are much warmer than others? Things like that. On the cold rooms, one of the key questions, which I can thank my friend Andy Frank for, is do you have to wear slippers or socks when you walk around on the floors in winter? You know, there's various things like that, or rooms that you just don't want to use sometimes of the year, things like that. And these are not yes or no questions. They're on a scale of 0 to 10, with 0 being not a problem and 10 being a big problem. And by asking these, you get a score. You know, maximum score is 40, you know, 10 per question, 4 questions. And we call this the comfort quiz, or the 4 questions. And if the technician on a TO ask these questions, or the CSR asks these questions, or we have this where you can plug it into your website, and that will ask the clients questions there, and then give them a couple of videos to watch for that third-party arbiter, which oddly enough is me in this case, because they're my videos, they're HVAC 2.0 videos, but it's not you, the company, saying this, it's someone else. And I'm the author of the Home Comfort book. I now have the air sealing course. You know, like I've got chops for this stuff. So if people go digging, they'll figure stuff out. But if you ask these 4 questions, and in this case, like if you are a salesperson and you're given a lead, you're probably going to ask these questions in front of the clients when you go. Maybe you'll get a chance to ask them before you go, but for free quotes, you're probably just going to be showing up and asking. But this helps people think about, oh, Yeah, you know what? Little Johnny's room is kind of hot and cold depending on the season. Or a big thing that I had a rash of it one summer is the second floor gets so hot that I sleep on the couch. I'd like to be able to sleep with my wife again. But the master bedroom's too damn hot in the summer. So I just go downstairs and sleep on the couch so I can actually fall asleep.
And she snores. Sorry.
No, that wasn't it. Sorry, my bad. Yeah.
I wasn't talking definitely about me.
In that case, it's definitely me. You get through that and it pops up a score. So you can see there's a 12 there. And what we found is 0 to 12, that's solid free quote territory. You don't really have anything that bothers you. 13 to 19, you need to decide whether you want to do a free quote or a comfort consult. The comfort consult involves the blower door, but you don't have to start with the blower door anymore to use 2.0. So the comfort consult, price it high, price it something like a grand or something like that, because if somebody says, yes, you got to go buy one or you got to go borrow one or figure it out, it's good to figure out if there's one you can go rent or borrow. But you don't need to buy one. It's not required at all anymore. But if they have a 20 or higher, they probably have an issue that's worth doing the more advanced process on. And then if they have one score that's 8 or higher, they probably should do a comfort consult. That's what we've been finding by running this quiz. But the vast majority of people score low. So they're free quote people.
Yeah.
I just want a new system. My system's broke. I want a new system. Okay, great. And to your point earlier, though, like the transactional versus relational, your guys tell you that some people are transactional and they turn out to be relational when you get out there, don't they?
Yeah.
So part of the relational is just asking people decent questions and listening.
And just because somebody asked for numbers or wants to know prices doesn't automatically make them transactional. Some of them, if they're like, oh, well, how much do you charge for this? Oh, we charge 10 grand. And then their response is, oh, well, this guy charges 8,500. Yes, that's transactional. But if they just ask a question, you give them a number, they absorb it and go, oh, okay. Then they're just wanting information. That's all.
Again, like you said, this is a purchase that most people are only going to make once, maybe twice in their life. I mean, I hadn't bought HVAC until I moved here to West Virginia and every freaking house needed HVAC, which actually I'm thrilled with personally. My wife isn't. We've bought 3 heat pumps. I've got a 4th one coming and I actually had bought a 5th, but then I sold it to a friend because we sold the house in Ohio and I didn't put it in because I knew that I wasn't going to get the money. It was going to cost me at least 15 grand to put the system in. And I'm like, what's he going to give me extra? Zero. So he's going to turn around and put the system in after he buys it. But it's not going to be my 15 or 20 grand. That's low for what I was doing, but I know people. So, but having to install the whole duct system and whatnot, that's a $25,000, $30,000 project generally is what you can expect.
Oh, yeah.
But in any case, most people aren't going to do this very often. And so they genuinely don't know what it costs. I mean, that's basically what's behind 3 quotes is you don't trust people. You don't know what the number is. So if you can build trust by asking questions, and I'd also recommend, like, if you're going to tell somebody a number, give them a range. You know, on a low side, it's probably around 10 grand. And it can go up to like 30, depending on what you need. You know, sometimes more. If it's a really complicated job or you got multiple systems, I mean, like, you kind of have to come take a look at it, you know. Or the other joke when people are like, so will you come over to take a look at the system? Like, I am more than happy to take a look at your system for free. When can you bring it by? Mm-hmm. And that could be a way to kind of dispel the challenge. Like, yeah, you got to pay me to show up at your house, dude. So in free quotes, I'd love for them to go away, but they're not going to. No. So we need to have a way for it. Or like we've talked before, in busy season, you charge. So that's fine. So it may be a free quote with a service charge, you know, or whatever you want to do. So you were lucky enough to be busy enough to be able to charge, but a lot of people aren't. So we need to have an option. But in any case, this is the report. This is out of the software that I'm going to be showing you. So this actually works now. Thank God. This has been such a pain to get to this point. But this leads to a conversation, and you may flip them from a free quote to a comfort consult, maybe. But most people you won't. And then here's the thing that I think you'll enjoy: sizing. Everybody loves talking about sizing, right?
Yeah.
So this isn't working fully the way we want. The next version is going to have, this will be automated, but we call this likely load range. So if you run an accurate load on a house, can it be lower or higher than you expect it to be?
Oh, yeah. Oh, lower or higher?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. I mean, normally a lot of times I see things that are too big. Rarely do I ever see it that it's too small, but it can happen.
Yeah, yeah. Well, so what we're trying to do here is create some doubt in client minds to understand that the load of a house, like I see this sort of range all the time, you know, where the bottom end might be a ton and a half if it's a really tight, really well insulated house, but the high end could easily be 60,000 or even 80,000 BTUs. Like I've seen some older homes where the furnace never shuts off. Like it's actually undersized with an 80 or a 90,000 BTU furnace. I haven't seen a lot of them, but I've seen a few. They've been older, leaky homes. So stack effect goes crazy, and you've got cold air coming to the bottom, rushing up the top, and they're just a train wreck. So that house, well insulated, you can have the load on it. But rather than giving people false certainty of what a load is, because if you don't know blower door, you don't know energy use, you don't know thermostat set points, you don't understand windows and insulation, you can easily be off plus or minus 50%. Would you agree?
Yeah.
And we've seen as much as plus or minus 70% just from blower door in cold climates. That's insane. That's not a calculation. That's a guess.
Well, and even doing the low, I've seen people accidentally get like, and we did this one time inside a Rightsaw. It was one house where we put it in, like this side was facing, you know, north. And it said that it was a 2-ton. And then we switched it just to see. And it literally, by switching the south side of the house, it went from 2-ton to 3.5-ton. Same fucking house.
Yeah, solar load can kill you.
You know what I mean? So, yeah, there's a lot of things that people think that they don't, that doesn't make a difference. It's not just, oh, it's 2,000 square feet. Oh, okay, it's this size.
Exactly. Yeah, it varies. I mean, you can see loads all over the map. What's crazy is we see in Cleveland, we can get heat loads on new homes to where it's 1,000 to 1,200 square feet per ton. So like one of the builders we worked with, he was building a 4,800 square foot house. We spec'd the 3-ton, no furnace. And he had 1,000 blower door on the thing. It was tight as hell. So it would have worked. That's not what he wanted to do. He did a hybrid, but that's what we told him would actually be where he'd land. And it kind of blew his doors off. Mm-hmm. So a 4,000 square foot house with the 3-ton for heating? That's not cooling. That's heating. That's insane. So there's a huge range. Now, you're not going to find houses like that very often.
Yeah.
But it's important for people to understand there's a big range. So we call it likely load range. And what we're aiming for, we've built a really simple calculator. I mean, really simple. It's based on U value times area times delta T. It's really, really simple. But we've run it past everyone in the group. And it just takes your zip code. It looks up what the design temperatures are for a city that's in your climate zone. And it runs the loads just briefly, bottom ends, top ends. And then you can show this to clients and be like, so... this might be a ton and a half. It might be 5 tons. I don't really know. You've got a 3-ton right now. Has that been working? And you're probably going to like for like it. But to your introvert thing, if you look at the bottom, without further information, the industry standard is to change equipment out for the same size that exists now. This is likely to maintain current comfort levels or slightly degrade them. Because like as we move to higher SEER and it doesn't dehumidify for crap, they're probably not going to be happy. But, you know, it is what it is. An accurate load calc to determine the right size equipment for your home is best done with prior energy use and an interview and a blower door test. These are part of an HVAC 2.0 comfort consult, which we offer. So did you just responsibly avoid responsibility for sizing?
Yeah.
So they're like, so what size do you think it needs? I don't know. What size do you think it needs? Because both of our opinions are equally valid. Neither one of us has the data we need.
We're guessing.
Yeah. So can you see this helping get you out of pinches?
Oh, yeah. Fucking right.
and your salespeople. So this will be automated soon. It's not yet, but it will be. Right now, you have to plug numbers in. And we figured out that the people that we're aiming for this next time around probably aren't going to know how to do that. So we needed to automate it. So the likely load range was something we came up with. Now, another thing, you were talking about having people sign off. So here's duct pressure. We really think that 0.08 to 0.3 is where you should be. We're going to revise this so that 0.3 to 0.5 is green. It'll probably be a different color green. But I love systems when they run in the 0.08 to 0.3 inches of water column. They're dead silent. The ECMs are happier than a pig in crap. I mean, this is what we want systems to do.
Yeah, they don't sound like 747s taking off.
Yep. And a lot of people are like, well, you can't get there. I'm like, well, you can if you downsize it two sizes. You know, it's doable. You just need to reduce your airflow and reduce what airflow the system needs, which is by downsizing the system. But to downsize the system, you need to know what the load is.
Yeah.
And so that's a whole nother ballgame. But, you know, 0.3 to 0.5 is still pretty good. 0.5 to 0.7, you're okay. But, you know, be careful because all you need is a client to go close a couple of rooms off and spike their static and eat their ECM or their compressor.
Or filters not changed on time.
Yeah.
You know.
Exactly. All these pieces. I don't like that. So in this case, I just threw in 1.3 inch static. But we see this pretty often. Like, I'm surprised how often we see them over an inch. And I love them when they tin can. You turn on the air handler and you hear it go boom, boom.
Yep.
Like, ooh. That's an inch of static right there to make it tin can.
And what gets me is I seen people, I was riding with one of the techs one day and I doing a maintenance and I was just training them riding. And I saw this like brace with slip that somebody put on the drive. And I asked the lady, I'm like, hey, what the hell is this? Like, you know, what? She's like, oh, the last company, because my unit was oil canning. I'm like, oh, yeah. And it was doing that. They did this to brace it. And I was like, oh, so they just covered up the noise. She was like, what? I'm like, ma'am, I'm like, your system's doing that for a reason. I'm like, just because they covered up the boink, boink, you still have an issue. You just don't hear it anymore. So it took a few times of earning her trust and stuff like that. And we ended up changing a whole bunch of stuff out there. She didn't go with a fancy system because it was a rental property for her, but she decided to do stuff because she was renting it to a family member and it was going to be in the house. She was going to have it for a long time. But when I heard that, I was just like, what the fuck?
Weird crap happens. So what we suggest in this and what's built into the software is there's the 90-second video I mentioned that you can play for the homeowner right there that compares various things. And it talks about how ECMs are the new kind of blower motor. It could be an X13, obviously, and how they don't deal with static pressure the way that PSCs used to. So your old system might have survived what it's going through. The new system, not so much. So you need to be aware of this. So you give them a little bit of education, and then we recommend, this is going to be the hard part, is some of the newbies are going to be nervous about doing the duct pressure testing, but we recommend offering the testing for $25 or $50. Cheap. But you're there for free anyway. And the point here is not to make money. The point is to make money change hands. Like my favorite scene from Breaking Bad, when they have a bad cook and Better Call Saul shows up and they're about to shoot him. And he's like, wait a minute, put a dollar in my pocket. What the hell do you want me to do that for? He's like, you want client attorney privilege, right? You have to put me on a retainer, put a dollar in my pocket. And they both do. And he goes from getting shot to being their lawyer. So he goes from transactional to relational with a 1 and a 5 in his pocket. And that's what the goal is here. Is offer it cheap, or if you're not comfortable with it, you can send a tech out. And we really think that when you're doing maintenances, it's really good to take duct pressure, see where you are, so you understand where the system is, and you understand where your risks are in some systems that you might not otherwise. That's a pain in the butt to implement, but it can be done. But in that case, the salesperson shows up, and you know, through Service Titan or whatever you're using, they know what the duct pressure, the static pressure is.
Yeah.
But if you offer this testing for $25 after educating them and they decline, who owns that?
Say it again.
If you offer static pressure testing to a client and they decline the testing,
it's on them.
Who owns problems? Yeah. So you just responsibly avoided responsibility. And this is where a huge number of failures come. Huge number. So now you can have a different discussion when it comes. Now, if they decline, instead of showing what the duct pressure is, it says here, clients assume risk, which is kind of interesting. So can you see how this can be helpful to help you either avoid the responsibility or have a good discussion about potentially downsizing?
100%.
And if you're downsizing because you also told them that you don't know the information that you need, you can ask them, what size would you like us to downsize to? And I rode along here recently with one of our guys, and clients were going back and forth. They had a 2.5-ton heat pump. And I asked them, so do you notice it shutting off when it's really hot or really cold outside? And they're like, yeah, I guess it does. I'm like, okay, then it's oversized. Most likely, anyway. So you probably can downsize. Because they wanted a system that got the IRA incentive, which I freaking hate. And for the Daikin fit, only the 2-ton qualifies. So they had to get a 2-ton. But they ended up buying it, which is pretty cool. That's awesome. But he took static pressure, and it was like 0.5, so they were good to go with 2.5 tons. And that led to the sizing discussion, and they chose to downsize that sucker, which is pretty cool. Now, this is the last piece. This is the sales piece, and I don't love this yet. We have to I don't love the top part. I love the smiley faces, and we get a lot of good feedback on this. So there's the 6 functions of HVAC: load matching, dehumidification, filtration, mixing, fresh air, and humidification. Notice there's 3 here. These are controlled by the equipment. The second page is install, which controls the other 3. So, I mean, filtration isn't part of the machine. Fresh air coming in, that's not part of the machine. Humidifier, not part of the machine. So these are extra things that are part of the install, not part of the equipment choice. But note, it's all here with smiley faces. So yeah, like, I can sell you a single stage piece of crap. You're not going to tell them single stage piece of crap, but you know, this is a basic piece of equipment. And note that it's not very good at load matching. It's not very good at dehumidification. For mixing, which this is just running the fan all the time, it's not necessarily going to be ideal. It's not a super efficient motor, and you could choose different things for this one, to be frank. But you help them understand, like, you're not going to get these things. So now they've watched a little video, or hopefully they have, or you've begun to explain what the 6 functions are, how their car HVAC works. They're connecting the dots. And I showed this to a friend of mine. I was on his podcast, and he emails me back, I am offended that you would even try to sell me that piece of crap. And I'm like, John, we talked about it. That's what you have. You have a single stage air conditioner. That's what you bought. He's like, oh, like, so now he understands, like, yeah, it's not good. But rather than talking about what's the efficiency, this helps people understand what the legit differences are. So this is single stage. This is probably a 2-stage, and these are a couple of inverter systems. And you can change any of this. So like the basic good, better, best, I just threw that in here as an example. You can do whatever you want. But again, this came right out of the software. You can put it in for different heat pumps. You can put efficiency in. I think a lot of these things people are going to run without, because most people will have their own pricing structures. So you might put in here a pricing software. So you might show this to them with a range. And then once they narrow in on which system they want, then you can flip over to whatever your pricing system is and finish the transaction. But this will help them choose which one they want. So notice the whole time here, this is choose your own adventure. Do you want to go to the front door or the basement? Okay, basement. Great. So what do you want next? Do you want to do the static pressure or not? No. Okay, great. Sign here. Do you want to watch this video? No. Okay, fine. I'm going to click no, that you don't want to watch it. Or hopefully, like, you can hand them your iPad or computer or whatever while you go to look at the equipment, and they can watch the couple minute video.
Keep saying, so there's different ways. Instead of a smiley face, they get a...
Hey, you said it's the HVAC Uncensored version.
You know, fuck you.
Well, we'll have to create one just for you, Gil. Just for you. But can you see how this is very different from, oh, it's more efficient?
Yeah, no, and this resonates with people that aren't technicians. It's the information that they want to know to help them make their decision, but you're not overfeeding them shit that they don't. It's not they don't care. It doesn't resonate because it doesn't affect them. They're not trying to become an HVAC salesman. They want the information they know that resonates with them to make their decision.
Yeah. You're doing your best to educate them quickly, but accurately. Yeah. And that's the hard part. So, I mean, am I a nerd? Do I care about technical details? You can say yes, buddy. You can say yes.
That sounds like...
Yeah, I'm a nerd. Like I've always been a nerd. I've never truly fit in anywhere. So yeah, that's always a challenge. But this is technically correct and defensible from a building science perspective. And what surprised us in building out 2.0 is how often problems can be solved for clients with just the right HVAC. Or if not solved, substantially reduced to where the wife stops complaining or the husband can go back upstairs and sleep with his wife. You know, it's enough. And this is coming from someone, I mean, I'm a nerd on doing the shell work. I love doing the air sealing and insulation work and selling that stuff. Like, I love doing that. But realistically, most people aren't going to do that. But they are going to buy HVAC at some point.
Yeah.
You know, every house is going to get a new system someday.
Or if you're going to sleep with your wife again, you go back up to that likely load range and you tell her, hey, my wiener could be 5 inches. It could be 10. There's a range, okay? We got to get the humidity's got to be good. We got to have filtration, the dew point. All that's good. We get that top end. If it's not, we're closer to the bottom end. Sorry.
No, that's good. Well, so have you ever heard the joke? It's men like him that are why women think this is 6 inches. So, yeah, it's there's Uncensored for you. I don't get to tell that joke everywhere. So, and then the second piece here is your install choices. So notice what we're doing here. There's different filters, 1 inch medias across the top here. Fresh air, nothing. Just a 6-inch duct to outside, you know, just a scuttle, as I'm used to calling it, and then a ventilating dehumidifier. So you've got your different things that you can offer. Air quality, this is supposed to be for a monitor. I have to see if it will squeeze in there. Font size will probably have to shrink, but there's nothing where you can offer it as an option. So like we like the Haven air quality monitor because it's also a controller. So you can use that to turn things on and off. Where normally the monitors are frankly annoying. It's like a car alarm going off outside where you're just like, dang it, will somebody go shut that thing off? Like nobody cares if the car got stolen, and it probably didn't. Just, you know, it went off when a bird flew over it, or somebody didn't like the guy and kicked his tire, you know, whatever it is. It wasn't getting stolen. But mostly the air quality monitors are not particularly useful because they don't change anything when something's wrong. So the Haven's nice for that it actually will change things. And then note what we're doing here for pricing. If you want the 1-inch filter, we'll actually give you money back. It's a downgrade because we think it sucks. Our standard install involves a media filter. And this usually will make people think differently about what they're doing.
Yeah.
So this is what we're trying to chew through on this. And would your clients enjoy seeing this kind of information?
Oh, yeah, damn right.
And this doesn't take that long to come up with. Like, these are templates. So you pick which template you want, and you might adjust a couple of things. You can add or subtract some of these rows here if you want. But it's not a big deal to make it pop up. And this part isn't working just yet, but we're going to flip it so that you can ask clients, so do you prefer to see your expensive options first or your cheap options first? Or less expensive, whatever you want to call it. And it will flip it either way for presenting.
Yeah, and what I love about it is it's like giving a very detailed menu. That's what I got to think. Like you're the... You go to a fancy, like a nice restaurant, and they're like, oh, well, the specials are, you know, a porterhouse and sea bass. And it comes, oh, what's in that? Oh, it comes with this lemon, garlic, whatever sauce, and they explain it. And I hate to dumb it down like that, but I know a lot of people watch this, listen to a text or like, you know, oh, I don't want to offer customers things that they don't need. Well, this is why they're getting to choose what they want and don't want. You're not.
It's not your job to tell them what they need and don't need, really. Not what they need and don't need, what they want and don't want. Yes. Don't prejudge people. One of my best friends in college, his dad sold BMWs and was a sales manager. And this guy walks through the door in overalls, just filthy, stinking like hell. It turns out he owned a garbage company, but he still liked to be on the trucks. But he slapped down cash for 2 750 IL Beamers at like 120 grand a piece, whatever it was, cash, two of them, because nobody else went to wait on them, and John's dad did. So you know, don't prejudge people. You never know. My grandpa was in sales for years and years. He was president or CEO of like 6 or 8 different paint companies. And he's in his 70s and he's telling me, Nate, I have no idea what people are going to buy. I just make sure that they have a range of options and I let them choose whatever they think is best for them. But it's our job to provide good education so that they have been offered those options. And then if they do something different, they own the results because you told them your dehumidification is going to suck. Your filtration is going to suck. You're not going to have fresh air. You know, there's all these things. Well, would you like to add that now instead of having to go over there and pretend like you're making adjustments because all you have is airflow and refrigerant charge? Like, what are you really going to do to fix the system once it's in? You're not.
It's also going to help you at warranty when they try to call and complain. It's, hey, Mrs. Smith, remember when we sat down and we had this conversation? This is exactly what I told you was going to happen, did I not? Well, yeah, you did say that.
In writing.
Yeah, like, ma'am, you signed the paper. I tried to talk you out of this because I didn't want you to have to go through what you're going through now, and you still made the decision not to do it. And then, worst case scenario, it's like, hey, I mean, obviously, we can't go back in and change anything else. You've already bought the system. I can try to offer you some options to maybe help a few things, but, you know, now we're just throwing Band-Aids because we should have did this at the time of the system, you know?
Or would you like to go back and do that comfort consult that we talked about? You know, you can back up, but at least this time, you're not going to own a bunch of problems because, man, the callbacks, some companies run high callbacks. I've heard of a company recently that runs a third callbacks on their new installs. Clients are calling them back a third of the time on their brand new installs. That's crazy. You shouldn't have anything like that. No. Nothing like that. I mean, I come from manufacturing where you aim for Six Sigma, which is one failure in a million.
Well, don't have that.
That ain't Six Sigma. Yeah. No. We're missing pretty wide.
I keep it as a percentage. So we have a an Excel sheet that's built out that things automatically get transformed to. And I can literally see what the percentage of warranty calls ran. And if that goes below a certain number, above a certain number, you know, there's like steam shooting out of my ears. I'm like, this is just an equipment or is this a people problem? Because somebody's either a salesman's getting, either my rep's getting his fucking chewed out, or somebody else is going to get pulled in and get the what the fuck's going on.
Well, and what is that percentage? Do you mind sharing?
Normally, I don't like it to get below 20%.
Or above, rather. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Yeah, above 20%. I'm sorry. Yeah. So, because the fact that we give, we sell a lot of 10-year labor warranties, I got to be realistic. You know what I mean? There's going to be... Some of them are bullshit. They get mixed into that number. But normally I see if it gets above 20%, then normally it's something I need to look into. Like, hey, is there a recall I don't know about? You know, is there something that's going to make sense of why this number is elevated? You know?
There's all these pieces, parts. There's a lot of stuff to it. Well, speaking of which, I just want to show one more thing before we work on signing off here. But this is something that I'm super excited about. Because most salespeople don't measure shit at the end of the day. I mean, when we talked last time too, even when you're tech sell a job, you like to go out there and measure just to make sure that everything is pretty close to right. So we had some little illustrations made that you can take measurements on. And by the way, you can pick whatever you want. So like I have this with a furnace and a coil here, but I can switch it to an air handler and I can go upflow. I can go downflow, you know, horizontals on here. Like it's all in here. And then is it left or right? So that if somebody takes the measurements, they can put the measurements in here on their screen where they belong. So you're much less likely to have a failure.
Yeah. So we have an amazing install sheet. So I don't have to go back and double check that. I double check that they do the sheet before they leave. But, you know, so that way we have all the measurements, whether it's an A width, B width, C width, D width. If what we're going to go back with has, you know, the right, because you guys don't know, normally A is 14.5, B is 17.5, C is 21, and then 24.5. So normally in that, all manufacturers normally are within that range for the most part.
I expect you to do this shit. You're Gil fucking Cavey.
Goddamn right I am.
This can at least, like, you can have a salesperson at least get you close. And then if you have some photos to work with, you might be able to avoid a trip out for your measurements. Sometimes you're not going to be able to, but hopefully sometimes. And then here's static pressure. So here's where you punch your holes. Here's your measurements. And then it's just off screen at the bottom here. It shows what the, it just calculates it. It's not that hard. So 0.1 to minus 0.6, that's 0.7 between them. But now you've got all this information attached to the client file. And then the report that I showed you, this, once you get halfway decent at it, this is like 2 or 3 minutes to come up with.
Can you export?
Because you've already done most of it.
Like when you're done, can I export this to like save in a database?
Yeah.
Nice.
So yeah, we need to work on some API stuff still, but we can figure those pieces out. Like that's in the roadmap, but this is a PDF. So I just, this is a PDF that we're looking at here that I exported out of the system. So then you can tag this into whatever system you've got.
Dude, I'm telling you, man, if you can integrate this with like webhooks, those things, they're called webhooks. Or if you can get this to where this can add on to some of the CRMs out there, dude, you guys, people will buy this like crazy. And then you guys have that monthly income because their people are paying monthly for this. You know what I mean? As an add-on to their CRM, because I see other things that try to do something like this that can't touch it. They're just kind of junk. And really all it is just a place to put all your shit and send it so it's in a pretty package. But the problem is the people that are doing the stuff aren't doing that work. You know what I mean? They're not doing this in a step-by-step fashion.
That it's constantly the challenge of you need boots on the ground experience to build stuff like this, which that's been hard because I've never just sold HVAC. I only sold killer projects. Like I'd sell HVAC as part of that project, but I was not doing free quotes and running that. So that's part of what made this so freaking hard to figure out because I'm trying to build something for something that I've never done before and it needs to be good. So our goal here is we want this system to be so good that you feel stupid not using it.
Yeah.
We're not quite there yet, but that's the goal. That's where we're trying to get to. So a couple of things is just on pricing. There's two different tiers. And I totally forgot to pull up the, you know what? Hang on. I can do that. Duh. Let me show you the uncensored page. So if you go to HVAC2.0.com/uncensored and I need to zoom out there. You can see there's a button here for set up your HVAC 2.0 account. And we have it set up. So it's free for 90 days. You've got to pay for reports. But after that, it's $6 a month. Is where we have a price. So, I mean, this is dirt freaking cheap. Again, we're looking to get about a dozen people in, or a dozen companies and help us to polish this off and we'll hand train you in how to do this. But, understand it's not going to be perfect and we need your feedback. So those are the pieces. Did I not put the pricing in here? Where the hell did I put it? I didn't put the pricing in here. What a dumbass. All right, hang on. It's on the homepage. All right. So two different accounts, free for 90 days and $6 a month. That entry is free. Free quote reports are $10 a piece. What I just showed you, $25 for the comfort consult reports, and you have 90 days of access to it. You get access to a basic support group. Although in this case, we're cheating. You're going to get direct access, and then you don't get access to the advanced support group. And then the subscriber side's a couple $100 a month. There's a $500 setup fee. And then everything's unlimited beyond that. So basically, if you start doing a lot of this, just move yourself to a subscriber. Is kind of where it is. So this is probably too cheap, but we need to get everything running just the way we want it to. So again, it's so good that you feel like you're dumb if you're not using it.
Well, plus, and this is, I mean, for one, all of this, when you break it down, should be figured into the cost of the system. You're adding this in so that you're, as a company, you're not really paying for this. It's part of your service. So it's going to be a little bit. And then for you guys, you're getting this off of the quantity of people who use it, hopefully, on a regular basis. You know,
that's where we need to get to, exactly. Well, and so what we're seeing here is the people that are using this process are going from, you know, 85 or 90% single stage to 70 to 80% inverter, and their closing ratios are going up significantly too. So like 50, 60, 70% closing ratios can happen sometimes, particularly on comfort consults, that's normal. Like it's comfort consults are like amazing, like what the closing ratios are. They're usually 60 or 70% short term within say a couple of weeks or a month. And they're 80 and 90% over about a year. Cause oftentimes people just have to go find the money. The comfort consult jobs, they never die. People tend to not buy from anybody else because you just gave them all this information and you built all this trust.
So Jason Johnson asked,
oh, good question.
Yeah. 500 per company, or is there a limit on who has access?
So the basic account, it's one seat. So you get one login. The subscriber account has five seats, but we do strongly recommend that it's one per salesperson, one account per salesperson. Otherwise, you're not going to know whose numbers are what. If that makes sense, you know, like whose closing ratio is better. Like if you want to mix it all, it's fine, but whose client is whose, and, you know, it gets awkward.
Jennifer said, Nate, you should let me make you an ad for this.
Great. Manzo?
Yeah.
Sweet. Yeah. Message me, Jen. We've been meaning to chat anyway.
Yeah, she's the only Jen that's ever in my comments anyway. There was this one dude who called himself Jen, but I never talked to him. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
Okay. Hey, you never know. You never know. I try not to judge. So what we call this now, by the way, just scrolling to the top of the screen, we call 2.0 a technical sales process, because calling it a sales process is really kind of unfair to it because it's really technical. Like you know that the knowledge and the understanding and the care underneath this is very technical and very particular. This is not trying to pull wool over people's eyes. This is how do we genuinely help people find the right solution for them every time.
And like I always say, if we don't offer something, who's really in fault there? We are. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You know, what's that one they always say? You know, if you go buy a car and, you know, you buy a truck and you're like, oh, this is great. And you come home and you're like, man, show your neighbor, look at my new truck. And the neighbor's like, oh, cool. He gets like, the brand new tire package, the audio system, and all these other features. He comes home and you're like, well, what the fuck? The guy never even said anything to me about that. You're going to be pissed. You know what I mean? It's the same concept. Give them the option. If they want it, great. And be smart enough or educated enough to answer their questions. I mean, that's pretty much what it comes down to. We've had pretty good comments. It's been a good group in here, but I just hate it when you bring up the word sales at any time. You know, a lot of techs who
want communication.
Yeah, well, that's normally why I say I we don't have sales meetings. We have communication meetings at Beltway, and it's just they strive away from it. But I feel like, you know, and I hate to say this, I was gonna make a video about this because I feel like there's so many guys out there, and I'm saying guys because I haven't seen it in the women too much. But there's so many guys out there that they try so hard to be the good guy that they're doing a disservice to their customer. And that's just the truth. They mind fuck themselves into oh, well, they can't afford that, or they can't do this, or they don't want me to be here that long. And they end up screwing their customer. And I hope that those people realize that, because I know their intentions are good, but the outcome's not.
You always want to offer options. And so one other key thing here. So Tanner Dickerson, one of our guys, he's amazing. What a young gun. Actually, you might want to have him on one time, because he's freaking hilarious. Yeah. And I'm being kind of calm and not too profane tonight compared to what I'll do sometimes. he'll mix it up. He's into that. But he went to a Sandler training that talked about how, like, we want to have adult relationships with people. We want to talk to them like they're adults, not like they're children. But
I didn't know that's where you were going with that. But that's what I was thinking too.
That's exactly great. But the line that stuck with me was, if you're doing sales or communication right, it's two adults working together to find the truth.
Yeah.
And that truth is going to vary. Like, the truth in this case is what piece of equipment is best for them and their home and their situation right now. That might change, with either a different homeowner, or if that person was 5 years older or 5 years younger, but you're trying to find what the best solution is for them right now.
Yeah. It's not the sales where it's, just the husband. And it's like, oh, how long you been married, bro? Oh, 7 years? Oh, you don't make decisions out your wife? What are you, a pussy? Huh? You ain't got no testicles? Come on, you should do this and your wife be happy. I'm like, no, man, that's fucking stupid. Don't do that.
Yeah.
I listen to some of those things and I'm like, yeah, I'll never be that guy.
I hate those processes. So this is this is based on the Sandler sales process, which I highly recommend people look into. The book for it is You Can't Teach a Kid to Ride a Bike at a Seminar. Or there's one for selling to homeowners, and I forget what the title of it is. It's something close to that. But what you're trying to do is the first step is you want to understand what their pain is, what they want to fix. And that's what we're trying to do in asking a bunch of questions. And like, does anybody have allergies? Anybody have asthma? Are there any rooms don't heat or cool well? Like, you want to ask these questions so that you understand if problems are there or not. Love it. It's a red letter day. It's July 4th again.
Sorry. I'm sorry. I got to do the...
Oh, you got to play with the buttons you were telling me about. You haven't seen
it. Yeah, no. Shit. What the fuck happened to the lasers? There it is.
There we go. That's what we need right there. Can you do it behind me? Or is it just you?
Oh, yeah, I can. How about that shit?
Sweet. Check it out. I can have a better background for a change.
No, I thought it was going to let me choose a different person. Hold on. Let me see. Let me go over here. Come on. I need to.
Now you're distracted. I love it.
Yeah, now it's not letting me fuck.
But what you're trying to figure out is what bothers them. What's their budget realistically to deal with it? You getting cold now?
Yeah.
And then if you can find them a solution that solves those problems within that budget, do you have to close them? No, they just say yes.
Yeah, no.
Like, I found what I wanted for the price that I want. Okay, let's go.
And it's amazing what people will pay to fix problems that they know they have. Hey, we have this problem. I didn't know that you could even fix... I didn't know the HVAC guy could take care of that problem. But yes, I would love to fix that.
Exactly. You dust more in this house than you've ever dusted before in other houses. That could be a filtration problem. Could also be sucking cellulose through things, but that's another story. But it definitely could be filtration. There's all kinds of different pieces of the puzzle. And if you don't... try to ask some questions and understand what those are. And by the way, I didn't show in the software, there's a script for free quotes that we pulled key questions out of the comfort consult. So it's way, way shorter. It's about 15 minutes of questions versus an hour. And at that point you've documented. So if the client tells you it's not a problem, then later like, well, but you said it would fix this. I'm like, you didn't tell me it was a problem. And look, I wrote it down right here. Like, am I supposed to be psychic? So it's another piece of responsibly avoiding responsibility, but just a little bit of time asking people questions and you can understand, do they have something they want to fix? And then you can offer them solutions.
Yeah, no, that's very true. Damn, dude, I wish we could keep going. We're almost at 2 hours.
It's late. I know. Yeah, this is longer than I meant as well.
Here, man, do the
game over, man.
Yeah, time to go. Here, let me switch back to the other screen.
Yeah, get my webpage off.
Dude, I think you guys, for one, I think you guys have done an amazing fucking job with this, man. I think, I know how you said you had to kind of go a little bit backwards, but I think you guys started off in the right way because you earned the credibility with the truly technical people out there. The ones who are going to do the better job offering it, but weren't necessarily salespeople. So now you can kind of back this up to be able to let other people know, like, hey, I can do a really good job by doing this. And you're going to set yourself apart from those other motherfuckers that are in your area that are going out there. Oh, you got a 4-ton? Here's a 4-ton. There you go. You know what I mean? And we're going to have a lot more happy customers. And they're going to understand that there is people out there that want to do the right thing, you know, do a really good job. Is it going to be for everybody? No, you're still going to have those shitty systems that you're going to sell that's all they want. Like we talked about before, the free quote, the transactional people. But at least now you have different avenues when something happens. You know, so I think it's fucking awesome, dude. And like I said, we're actually building a true sales department now. We kind of have to at where we're going. But I love trying to implement something like this, and we've talked not like this, implementing this, and we've had several talks about it. So
yeah, well, we'll figure it out, dude. Because I'm excited for you, and you're at a key place, like somewhere like it used to be 3 million a year, where you kind of had to take your tools off and become a manager, whether you wanted to or not, if you wanted to grow beyond that. And now it's more like 4 or 5 million because the ticket prices are up.
Yeah.
But you get to a certain point and it's like, you can't sell it all. You're going to have a sales department to go to the next level. You just are.
Yeah. Me and Ryan can't do it. And if we're trying to work on the business, you know, not in the business, you know, we got to be planning for, you know, 3, 6 months, a year down the road. You know, casting that vision, which Ryan does amazing at, the vision of where we're going, what we're doing.
You two are hilarious, by the way. I love watching those.
He was actually going to come on with me last week. I didn't have a guest, but he texted me like, hey, I'll come on, man, if you want. And I was like, yeah, I had to cancel the show because my shit was fucked up. So
it happens, dude. It happens.
It's good. I got credits with the editor, so we're good. Normally I keep around an hour because the longer it goes, my editor charges me more money, but I actually got credits, so we're good.
Good. So we're gonna burn some of your credits.
Yeah.
That's all right. Let's work one-on-one and figure this crap out.
Yeah, no, but yeah, man, let me start closing this out. But once again, man, there's a reason that you've been one of the, you know, most frequent guests on here. Like I said earlier, man, I love the conversations we had. And even when we talk about this, even the conversations that branch off of it and different things we talk about, anytime there's an episode with you and somebody watches it, I know they're getting value. They can take something from it, which obviously they're my customers. That's what I'm trying to do. So yeah. I love it, man. And you know, you're always welcome on here anytime, bro.
Appreciate it. One of these days I'll come out and see you too.
Yeah, no, for sure. Once I finally move and can settle down, I'm going to start getting out and about and doing some more traveling. Plus, I'll also have the studio where it'll be something like this, but I'm going to have a studio for people come in. I'm going to have more people in studio.
Nice. Okay. Yeah, we'll figure that out. You're only about 5 hours from me. So.
Yeah. So it'll be awesome. Like I said, once I finally move, maybe next summer or next fall, because people are busy in the summer, I might try to throw a big shindig and invite some people. So we'll see what happens.
Sweet. All right. Till next time, Gil.
Yeah. Real fast. Where can people? So where do people go to get this? And that link that had both of us, is that an offer that's for everybody, just for people that go through here, or what was that?
The pricing that is for everyone, but okay. the first dozen people that sign up and start using and get the one-on-one help. That's an uncensored offer right there.
Nice.
So let's try and fill those up. But if you go to HVAC20.com/uncensored, there's the sign up link there, and there's some questions and stuff. But if you do that, my partner Ted will be in touch with you shortly, and then we will start figuring stuff out. So help us polish this off and help us make things better in the industry. Help us make your company better.
Yeah, no, for sure. And Jen, trust me, you are coming on. Before we get off of here, I am going to message you a link so that you can schedule, girl. Because I still need to get, like, I want 18, A-Team Adam to come on, like all the overtime guys, but I want them individually because they all have their own personalities. They deserve their own show. You know, I don't want to bring them on at one time.
Chris. By the way, Chris, message me. I'll help you set up your Infinity stat because I know a thing or two about setting those up.
Yeah, because it gets tricky. Yeah. All right, buddy. Thank you, man. I appreciate you. I'm gonna close this thing out, my man. All righty. Here, nobody can still hear him. There we go. Hey guys, thank all of you for sitting through this 2-hour show, man. It's absolutely I have so much fun when Nate comes on because we get to talking about things and time lapses. This may be a 2-part episode. This may be one really long one. We'll see. excuse me. Make sure you guys stay. Probably in the next day or so, I'm going to make a post. I'm going to put it on Facebook and Instagram. And I'll probably do a YouTube short as well where telling you how to win this bag. Like I said, you have to be a Bluon member. Go download the app. Give me your information. You have to be in their database. Okay. Should you use the app and use all the amazing stuff? Yes. But when I hit up Jessica from Bluon and I give them a name, if it doesn't pop up in the Bluon database, then you're not going to be able to win. So, you know, it is going to be, it's a tech, a video tech LC, Adrian. And then obviously in the next week or so, it will also, I'll be giving how to win the Yellow Jacket stuff. I have some more giveaways. So real fast, so a lot of you guys know, you haven't seen me much on social media, and I'm going to offer an explanation here very briefly since we're already at 2 hours. At my church, our pastor's been talking about something called a digital cleanse. And I'm going to make a video about this tomorrow as well. So if you guys want to watch it on Instagram or Facebook, but I did this thing where I was trying to put my phone down and I wanted to see how bad it was, my screen time and stuff like that. And it was pretty bad. I download this app. I forget the name. I want to say it's called like Q or something like that. But you can literally do it to where it was only giving me 15 minutes in each individual social media platform for a week. Guys, I went through that in one day. All right. I went through it in one day and it made me realize how much that shit was controlling me. I was coming home, sitting down, watching videos, and my family's there. And I wasn't even being productive. I was watching videos of dumb shit. And I needed to take a break at the same time, do the podcast and the work I had, but not be on there being stupid. So that's why I was off. I completed that. You know, I did it for 60 days and, I'm going to be back out and doing stuff, but I'm going to discipline myself. And I have this app where it gives me so much time into certain apps. And when that is done, I can't get back into it. So I want you guys to think about it. Watch a video tomorrow. I'm not going to keep you any longer. So, all right, man. Thank you guys, man. I appreciate you. I'm going to close this out. Guys, remember, be safe out there. We all got somebody to make it home to. You know what I mean? Whether it's driving, nuts on the road, electricity. Oh, I turned that breaker off. Double check. All right. Just be smart. I want all of you to make it home the same way you left. Next is going to be do the little things, man. Set yourself apart from the next guy or girl. Keep trying to be better. All right. Master your craft. I steal that from Ben Poole. That's not mine. Whether it's a podcast, a book, an online class, whatever it is, keep doing something to make yourself better. Or if you're really good at what you do, God damn it, give back to somebody else. Help the next generation. Give back to it. All right? We together have got to keep making our trade and our industry better. And we got to hold each other accountable by doing that. You know what I mean? So with that being said, I love you, mofos, and I'll talk at you next week. All right? Peace.
Thanks for listening to the HVAC Uncensored Podcast. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Instagram, or email us anytime at hvacuncensored@gmail.com. Now, get back to work. Shut this down. The views and opinions shared on the HVAC Uncensored Podcast may not necessarily be the views and opinions of our sponsors or guests.